Hey, it's Kim, and I'm back with another Amazon favorites video because Amazon just keeps coming with the hits. Am I right or am I right? Now, who doesn't love Amazon? Wait, before you answer that, I am well aware that there are some ethical issues for which some people might hate Amazon, but that's not this video. That's not this video. But I am going to go into some of my personal favorites that I like to get from Amazon. And if you're into Amazon as well, I hope that these can be of service to you. I do already have a couple of Amazon favorites videos on my channel. One is all about vacation things that I bought from there. The other one is about home items or things that I really like to keep for the home. And this one, since I'm on a planner kick, it's all about planning supplies and the things I like to purchase from Amazon. While I'm well aware that that is like a very long rabbit hole of stuff that you could possibly get from Amazon for planning, I decided to focus this video on if you're starting a new planner or at least refreshing the planner that you currently have. Since we're still at the top of the year, a lot of us are starting new planners, starting new systems, and refreshing the ones that we've been using previously. So that's the focus, the main focus of this video. I'll be walking you through a lot of the items, the basics that I consider, that I like to use to put together a planner. And these are mostly focused on ring-bound planners, but I'm pretty sure there are still some uses, I know that there are some items in this list that could be used for book-bound planners as well, because I do both. Book-bound planners as well as ring-bound planners. So let's get into it. First things first, paper. You need paper on which to plan. Duh. So when I first started printing out my own inserts and everything, I was primarily using a disk-bound system, and at the time I would use 32-pound paper. That switched this year when I started using ring-bound planners because I felt like the 32-pound paper was a little bit too thick and it added extra bulk to my planners, which I didn't necessarily need because I like to stuff a whole lot of things in there. So I did switch to one of the more highly rated 28-pound papers that you can find on Amazon. The one I'm currently using is made by HP and I really do like it. It's very bright white, so I will say that some people aren't into super bright white paper because depending on what you have it next to, it could lean a little blue or a little cool in tone. So do keep that in mind if that's something you're sensitive to or if you just prefer creamier looking paper. But overall, I really do love this paper. It's very smooth and I feel like when I cut it, the cut lines are also smooth as well. I never knew that this was a thing, but the previous paper I was using, I believe it was a Staples brand, and it was a 32-pound paper, but I felt like whenever I would cut it, the edges felt a little rough, almost like it needs to be sanded or something like that. I don't know what this is called. Maybe there's a term in like the paper world, but that's something I don't prefer. And I noticed immediately when I switched to the 28-pound HP paper. I will note also for the pen lovers out there, this paper is semi fountain pen friendly. And I say semi because if you write with a thicker nib or a very wet ink, you might notice that the ink does feather. It doesn't bleed through, but it may feather a little bit. So if that bothers you, this may not be the paper for you. I use fine nibs and extra fine nibs, and it seems to work just fine for me. I'm using this 28-pound paper to print out a month on two pages. This is a freebie from Peanuts Planner Co. if you're a part of her Facebook group. So I'm printing that out in the A6 size, which is the size of this planner. Originally, I thought I would not need a month on two pages inside of my work planner, but as I've used this for a couple of months, I'm realizing that I do like that monthly overview. So I found a freebie, and this one is absolutely perfect, and I've printed that out on the 28-pound paper so that I can stick it into my planner and use it as I need it. In the same category of papers, of course we like our planners to be pretty yet functional, but they also must be pretty. So I do like to get a lot of my basic papers from Amazon. And that means vellums or cardstock, just things I like to print out, decorative dashboards or if I'm printing something that I know I want to keep for a very long period of time, that's something I'll print out on a heavier, thicker paper that will last me a longer time. In this video, I'm setting up my work planner, actually. I'm refreshing it a bit. I started using it back in October or November, and I felt like for the new year, I just wanted to freshen it up a bit, add some things that I felt like I was missing, and just make it look a lot better. I will admit that this planner is mostly for function, not necessarily for form, but I still want to like it whenever I open it up. So I've printed out a few decorative elements, and I'm using this parchment paper that I picked up a couple of years ago, but Amazon does still sell it, and I'm printing out this GTD Get Things Done process list. It's a freebie from Sweet Caress Design. So I printed that out on this parchment paper, and the parchment paper isn't very transparent. It's only like slightly transparent. So that's why I do like it. So it's not super transparent like a thin vellum would be, but it does still add some interest and texture to your planner. Another paper that I've been loving lately is this linen cardstock. The one that I have is the bright white color, and it has a linen texture that I'm not sure if you can really pick up on screen, but if you've seen linen paper, that's basically what this is. I do feel like there's a better side to print on. The side that feels a little more textured is the side that I choose to print on. And I'm making for myself more of a decorative dashboard. I'm using this freebie from Hey Planner Girl. It's a floral freebie that she has on her site. I printed that out on the linen paper, and I'll cut it to size so that I can stick it into my planner, probably in the front, just so that it welcomes me as soon as I open it up. But I feel like that's another spot or another opportunity to add a little bit of my personality to this planner. I do also buy vellum paper from Amazon, and I'll have that linked down below for you as well. So now that we have all of these amazing inserts and decor printed out, of course we need to cut the paper. We need to cut the paper. And since I've been in the planning world for quite some time, just to give you a little bit of backstory, I've been using a planner probably all my life, but the earliest version of a planner that I actually have, and I still, you know, have it in my collection, is from 2014. So it's been a very long time. So I have gone through quite a few different paper trimmers or paper cutters. I will say they all have their faults and none are absolutely perfect, unless of course you're using some like industrial type commercial machine or something. But recently I have purchased this bypass paper cutter, and it's basically one of those ones, it reminds me of those old school paper cutters, maybe I'm telling my age, but that they used like in school when your teacher was printing out dittos, as they used to call them. But it has that long blade of an arm that you chop down the papers with. So this one I find to be very helpful because I can cut multiple sheets of paper at a time. I normally like to stick to around 5 sheets of paper because I find that it doesn't have a clamp, so it doesn't clamp down the pages. So if the stack that I'm cutting is way too thick, then some of them might shift as the blade is going through it. So I stick to around 4 or 5 sheets of paper. But I like this because I've noticed when I cut fewer pieces of paper at a time, I feel like the edges aren't as crisp and they don't line up as well when I put them into my planner. Of course, they won't be as perfect as something you buy straight from a distributor or a retailer who sells pre-cut papers. They won't be that perfectly straight or even, you know, throughout the entire stack of your pages, but this helps me get as close as I possibly can. So I do use this to cut the majority of the paper that I need for my planners. There's another kind of paper cutter, most notably called like a paper trimmer, that you use to cut fewer sheets of paper at a time. I don't like to use this one to cut the planner inserts, the inserts that I'll write on, but I do like this to cut the thinner or more decorative pieces of paper, and I'll explain why. Using the paper trimmer is really helpful, especially for thinner sheets of paper. I find that if you're cutting like one at a time on the bypass paper cutter, the sheets of paper kind of shift around. They're not heavy enough to stay down flat. So for that reason, I'll cut vellums or the parchment, and I'll cut those using the paper trimmer. Normally, I'm only cutting one or two at a time, so this is the most preferred tool to use for that purpose anyway. And after we cut out all of our inserts and decorative papers, we have to punch the holes. Now, I feel like if you are a planner and you use rings, this tool is an absolute must to have in your arsenal, because if you do need to punch holes into your paper so that they can fit on your rings, I do find that having more of a universal kind of paper or hole punch is definitely helpful. And what I mean by universal, it has settings for you to punch, I think, 6 or 7 different sizes of inserts. So depending on the size planner that you're using, the holes are spaced a little bit differently. For instance, a pocket size planner has 6 holes, but it's not 3 holes and then a space and then 3 holes. It's all 6 together. So with this tool, you can actually slide the settings in towards each other so that all the 6 hole punches line up together, or you can separate them according to whatever size that's listed on the back of the hole punch. So obviously, if you have a larger size insert, like an A5, you need the holes to be spread out even wider, so on and so forth. So having something like this that is more universal and you can use it for multiple purposes and multiple planner sizes is extremely helpful. Otherwise, you'd have to have one of these for each size planner that you own, which just isn't very efficient if you ask me. The next thing on my must-have list for setting up a planner, and you can take or leave this one, I think it's just really, it boils down to personal preference. So this is my corner rounder. I like to use this specifically, especially if I'm using a bound book and I have cut the edges down and I don't like those sharp points at the edge, I'll use the corner rounder to shape them up or to smooth them out a little bit. And especially if I'm trimming down vellum or acetate, because those corners can actually be pretty sharp. I know it sounds weird, but those corners, especially on like a laminate, can be pretty sharp and can poke you, you know. Again, a personal preference. Maybe you agree, maybe you don't, but I like to use a corner rounder for that purpose. And the one that I have here actually has a spot for different sizes of corners or different sizes of roundings. It goes, the small is 3 millimeters, the medium is 5 millimeters, and the large is 8 millimeters. And this has come in very handy for a lot of purposes for my planning use. All right, and no planner's arsenal is complete without label makers. Label makers are very important. I really don't understand why a lot of them are so pricey, but they're very important. Like, I would love to have a label maker that prints white font. Maybe one day I'll get one, but as long as the ones that I currently have are still operating and still functional, I'll just stick with what I've got and use them accordingly. So I do like to label just about everything in life, but especially as it relates to my planners, I like to customize my dividers, because I know that there are stores that sell dividers that are already pre-labeled, but those don't always fit my needs. So I do appreciate the stores that will customize, or the shops that will customize your divider labels, but if I'm just whipping something up myself, my label maker fits the bill and it does the job perfectly. I've had this Dymo LetraTag label maker for years and it has held up extremely well. It is battery operated, so it never dies. I don't have to worry about charging it up or anything like that. So I'm using these to label the dividers in my work planners. I especially like to label them myself as well, just in case things change, just in case I realize that I want to, I don't know, swap out a section or swap out a divider or rename it or something like that. It just allows me to really customize my planner for my own personal use. Another label maker that I don't show an example of using in this video, but I do have it in my previous videos, would be this Dymo embossing label maker. It's one of those like old school kinds of label makers, and it prints out a label on the plastic by pressing the numbers and the letters into the plastic tape that it prints out. I really do like this one as well, especially for deco. If I'm trying to make like a fancy looking divider or a fancy looking notebook, I like to use this type of label maker, and it's very inexpensive as well. Another item that I do truly love, and I feel like it's a personal preference, not everybody needs to have it, but it especially comes in handy when I'm putting my planners together and customizing it. And that would be a laminator. You can find these really inexpensive, especially on Amazon. You can find them in your local stores, like craft stores, as well as like your big box stores. You can find them just about anywhere and they're not expensive at all. I like to use a laminator for some of those items that I mentioned before. So if it's a printout or a reference sheet of some sort that I need to hold on to for a very long period of time, I like to laminate it so that it won't get messed up, so that I know that I'll have it for a long time. And that's exactly what I did here in setting up my work planner. I wanted to print out the steps or the process for processing invoices, which is something I do regularly. It's not all that new, but there are additional steps that I needed to add because we have different things to track. So I wanted that all in one spot so I could reference it easy peasy whenever I needed it. So I figured I'd just go on a Canva, whip something up using the free templates. I do have the free version of Canva, not the pro version, so you can do this with that. I found a template to use that coordinated very well with my planner. And I typed in all of the steps that I already had written down on a piece of paper that I keep in my planner, but I just wanted to make it prettier. So I customized that, printed it out for the size for my planner, and then laminated it. And then once that was all laminated, I cut it down to size. And of course, I rounded the corners so that they don't stab me. But I rounded the corners, and I did cut slits into the holes that I punched so that I can move it around as needed. So something in this instance, because I need it to last a long time, and also because I know that I'm going to be using it a lot. So I'm going to be moving it around my planner a whole lot. So I need it to stand up or hold up to all that abuse. So that's another reason why I wanted to laminate this insert. So I cut slits in the hole so that I can move it around. For instance, if I'm doing invoicing this week, I can move it to this week in my planner, and then on the weeks that I'm not using it, I'll just move it back to my reference section. So that's how I'm using it. There are a few other reference items that I like to add to my planners as well, and that's where the laminator comes in handy. So while I could continue about all the amazing things that we can get for our planners from Amazon, not to mention the pens, pens are also wonderful, I'll end it here, but I do want to include an honorable mention. So we're talking about these planners and these inserts and printing out all these things, but we didn't actually talk about the planner cover. So if you're in the market for a planner cover, I do know that there are hundreds sold on Amazon, but probably the most notable brand that a lot of us in the planner community will buy from Amazon are Moterm planners. I do have a few of my own. I don't have any of the ring planners from Moterm. I have an A6 for a bounds book, B6, and an A5, all from Moterm, and no complaints, and I do quite like them. I'll have them linked down below as well. So that's an honorable mention. If you're in the market to actually get a planner cover, I would suggest checking out the options that are available on Amazon as well. And if you're not into leather, because Moterm is mostly leather planner covers, you can find those PVC types of covers, you can find vegan leather covers, all of that, the whole gamut, the whole rainbow of planner covers available on Amazon. If you are currently setting up a planner yourself, or in the market to just refresh the planning system that you currently have, I truly hope some of my suggestions today will be helpful for you. Also, if you have any suggestions for me, feel free to leave them down in the comments below. Also, if you have any questions about anything I've shown in today's video, you can leave that down below as well. Again, I'll have everything I mentioned linked in the description box. And thank you so much for watching this video. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next one.